So welcome everyone. Depending on where you are, good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, or even sort of middle in the night, if you are currently in Australia. Welcome to the fourth session of a workshop on the subcortex, and this session will be on networks. And today I'm quite excited to have three speakers, or three talks basically. The first talk will be by Andreas Horn. He's a clinical researcher at the Charité in Berlin, and you might know him from his work on predicting clinical outcome based on connectomics from resting state or diffusion weighted data. And if you don't know him from that, you might know him from the awesome software package called LeadDBS, which is a open source software package which you can use to analyze and visualize the placement of leads. And yeah, it's a really cool package. Then followed by Suzanne Haber. I think if you've ever written a paper that has a area in the cortex and a area in the subcortex, and you're interested in parallel or integrative networks, then the chances are high that you cited her work. She does a lot more than only this type of work based on our research lines in her lab. Today she'll be talking about the frontal connections on the zona incerta and the subthalamic nucleus, which I think really ties in nicely to the talks that we had before by Jonathan Lau, for instance. And then finally, we have a talk by Yi Tian and Andrei Zelensky will basically be present. It's going to be interesting how they organize this. But Yi's a postdoc in the lab of Andrew, and you might know her work by the atlas that she recently published on the Melbourne subcortex atlas. Is based on 1,000 subjects, and it has these multiple levels of details. And you might know the work by Andrew if you've ever done anything on network statistics and you try to correct for family-wise errors, you're basically using his tools, right? So I think the list of speakers are super interesting and quite complementary. But before we can actually get started with the real work, I'll give a short intro on the topic. So why would you care, right, about networks and about the cortex and the subcortex? Well, I think it's, you know, for me, it's sort of obvious that if you want to understand the sort of structure-function relationship in the brain and you want to understand how functions are actually implemented in the brain, you need to look at the entire system, right? So we mentioned the workshop is on the subcortex, but you know, not a single area is an island. They're connected to other areas, and I think that's obviously clear when you start looking at sort of these networks. A clear example, as I mentioned already by mentioning the work by Suzanne, thinking about these parallel integrative information flows throughout the brain, you have these specialized cortical areas that project downwards to the subcortex, where you either have a separation or an integration of information, and that feeds back into the thalamus, which either is then again specialized or not. So if you want to understand how this works, you basically need to look at both, but also at the connections in between. You can also use it to inform your computational models, right? So I'm also very excited that tomorrow we'll have Michael Frank present his work. And I think one of his models is becoming a classic in understanding how action selection works in a brain and how you can actually generate computational models out of it and predictions for cortical, but also subcortical areas. Even if you wouldn't care about structure-function relationship, right, I think it still makes sense to acquire diffusion-weighted type of data or resting state or task-based data, because it actually allows you to parcellate the brain because you acquire an additional contrast, right? So especially with diffusion-weighted data, but also resting state, where you can look at these sort of connections or connectivity measures. And I think, if you use the structural scans for really looking at parcellating, I think, using diffusion weighted data for thalamus has been recently and several times already been shown that you can use these sort of contrasts to sort of parcellate the subregions in there. So I think that's already quite interesting. But you can also go one step further, and this is hopefully that Tian will be talking about, where not only can you use resting or task-based fMRI to parcellate the brain, but it also allows you to sort of ask these questions like, so if we are able to find such a delineation in the brain, you can actually go one step further. You can also look at the functional architecture, right? Are these discrete functions or discrete borders in the brain, or is it more of a gradient? And then how this sort of relates back into function. So I think, getting more of these type of informations in your database basically allows you to ask different questions than just only structure function relations. And finally, right? So, thinking about the rewards that are relevant for the different speakers that we have, you can actually start to predict clinical outcome of deep brain stimulation. So preemptively, you can start to plan ahead, not only by just having a single coordinate, but you can also start to think of, well, given the connection that this individual patient has, what would we expect if we place an electrode at a given location? And would you expect certain side effects? And would that actually be counter? Would that be a bad thing, basically? So this is the work that Andreas has been doing. An interesting thing, what he shows here is also you have diffusion weighted data and resting state, right? So this is like a really interesting combination, but he also shows that independently, they can actually predict clinical outcome, which is, thinking about a sort of structure function relationship again, what do these different modalities actually tell you about how the brain functions? An example somewhat closer to home, right? There's a recent work by the Amsterdam Medical Center where they've been looking into the placement of the electrode and where you are relative to the medial forebrain bundle in OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder patients. And you can basically start to predict whether or not someone will be a responder or a non-responder depending on where you are relative to the white matter bundle. So, looking at these networks, there are multiple reasons why it would be interesting to do so. You can then ask a question, so why isn't everyone doing it, right? I think, well, there are a number of challenges, right? This is basically the picture that Carla Miller burned down to the ground, saying like, well, if you have diffusion on one end and you have all the other methods, this is not the end point. I fully agree, but given the time that I had to change my slides, that was somewhat hard-pressed. But I do think if you look at how we're using diffusion-weighted data in vivo standard, just with an off-the-shelf sequence, you're basically limited to these long-range association projections, right? And if you start to push your sequence or your methods, you can get into these short-range associations, but it's tricky, right? So you actually have to do quite a lot of optimization on your acquisition side, on your pre-processing side, and on your analysis side to really get to the level that you can start to think of, okay, these separate bundles, because that's what we're interested in, how they're actually connected, what did they tell you, and how do they vary across people? So scale is always an issue, right? Especially with diffusion, resting state, the voxels with API sequence isn't great either. With scale, also a very relevant problem is proximity, right? So we've been basically hammering the message like you have a lot of subcortical areas. And given that there is a limited space that these structures can be in, they're quite compact. Right. So you have a lot of small nuclei that are really close to one another. And, from a network point of view, okay, swap, right? If they're all on the outside, you can still trace them back to them. But if you closely look at the actual white matter architecture, you have all these nuclei down there, but you also have quite a lot of these fibers going in between these nuclei, right? So you have, for instance, we talked about the medial forebrain bundle with OCD, right? Where you actually want to be as close as possible, but you're very close to the comb system. You're close to the H2, so the fields of Forel. So if you really want to delineate or parcellate a single track, right? This is a spatial problem. And if you didn't have a voxel of say 2 by 2 by 2 millimeters, you're hard pressed for partial voiming effects. This brings me actually to the next point, right? So given that you have a voxel, and this is also to linking it to the talk by Carla Miller and a question by Pilou actually, complexity of your white matter architecture, right? So we sort of assume that, you have your white matter, you have these fibers, we know we have crossing fibers, but there is actually already quite a lot of work that's been shown that the white matter complexity or configuration isn't equal throughout the brain, right? So one of these classical areas has usually been taken is the corpus callosum, right? Well, today we learned by looking at the PLI images that that isn't as straightforward either. But, you know, main fiber orientation is from left to right. You have ascending paths, right? Your cortical spinal tract that goes sort of up and down. But if you then start to look throughout the brain, and that's what you see in your right corner here, in red, these are areas that are thought to have a single fiber orientation. In green, where you're already starting to mix up your signal by having at least two fiber orientations. And then in blue, you start to get into regions where you have at least three or more fiber orientations within a single voxel. Right, so this is somewhat problematic if you have very simplistic algorithms to basically do tractography with. And the image on the left is actually the work by Colin Miller, where you can show also combined with PLI, you know, what the actual orientation is. And what I really like in this figure is that the square that you see as an inset is basically corresponds to a single voxel that you'd normally get within diffusion weighted data. So this really shows that within a subvoxel, you have quite a lot of complexity and you need to try to model that. Well, it's not all doom and gloom, right? Because that wouldn't be a great start for a session. There are a number of solutions, a lot of them already discussed during the previous sessions. The easiest step, right, is get better MR data. So for diffusion, that would mean getting data with more directions, with more B values, with options that you can do top up, right, correct for these all these distortions. For resting state, it might mean that you want to optimize your echo times for the given iron-rich structures that you're interested in the subcortex, right? So that's on the MR acquisition side. You can do these fat maps that Madan was talking about to do this motion correction, that you actually have these nice sharp borders. But once you have that data in, you also should think of, you know, getting better subcortical atlases. Well, Pilou just published a algorithm where you can sort of parcelate a lot of these subcortical atlases or structures in the individual. But if you don't have the actual data to do it, you can actually use other atlases or probabilistic atlases. And then finally, I think that's also a nice combination with all the postmortem and the histology. We can start to think of better biophysical models, right? So I think for diffusion, it's a clear example, having these simple single fiber models compared to multi-fiber models, there's a clear benefit of having complexer models because they capture the underlying anatomy better. Well, that's, you know, more technical. Another thing is if you start to look at these fiber tracks, it would also be good to have some postmortem validation, right? So did you actually find a track and does it have the shape that you would expect based on postmortem? You can do this in animals, you can do this in humans. I think the examples that we had in the previous session on why postmortem DVI is somewhat challenging, but quite beneficial, were quite exemplary. And then finally, if you incorporate anatomical expertise, I have the pleasure of working with Annika in the lab, who is our home anatomist, but not everyone has that luxury. So there's this recent paper where Peterson, where you can do this sort of 3D virtual reality where you invite anatomists to sort of clean up your tracks so you can incorporate anatomical expertise. So these are just a few directions that you can think of to improve on your network type of analyses. And while keeping that in mind, I'd like to give a few house rules. We notice, right, 30 minutes presenters, 50 minutes questions, questions via the chat, please. In between presentations, we'll try to have a short break. And with that, I'd like to give the floor to Andreas. I'm really looking forward to your talk.
Thank you.